Violence from inmates is an accepted part of the job for warders at Brixton Prison. But now many are increasingly afraid of revenge attacks outside the bars on them and their families. A census among the officers has revealed more than 76 incidents in the last 3 years, ranging from abuse to knifings. Some of the incidents are unconnected with the fact that the victim is in the prison service, but others clearly aren't. The Prison Officers Association say the Home Office is unsympathetic.
Well, when they get posting, the Home Office themselves don't seem to bother about the family, i.e. they may have bought a house where they're coming from, or there may be a prison local to where they've joined the job. They don't seem to get posted back there, they seem to get posted miles away from where they originated from.
The report was compiled following the murder of Brixton prison officer Ian Pooley at a pub in Thornton Heath. He'd only been in the service for 18 months. Today, his father, Jerry, was back at work on the barrier at Brixton Prison, still too upset to talk. And Michael, another officer, would only talk in confidence about the two men who knifed him with a bayonet, leaving him off work for 7 months.
I don't tend to go out more in the dark now, and not alone. I tend to go out more in company now.
And what about the effect it's had on your family?
I'm a single man, so I've got no immediate family, but my parents and the rest of my family want me to leave the job and return back to Wales and start again.
Will you leave the job, do you think?
Yes.
A copy of the report has been sent to the Home Office with a demand that they investigate the problem thoroughly. Ken Andrew, Thames News.
Raymond Hay, who was 29, was found hanging from bars in his cell on F Wing on March the 2nd this year. He was due to stand trial on conspiracy to supply drugs. The inquest heard this morning that Raymond Hay had been moved on the day before his death from a two-man cell on A Wing to F Wing, which is used to house mentally disordered inmates. A pathologist said that traces of cannabis had been found in his bloodstream, causing the coroner, Sir Montague Levine, to ask how it was that cannabis could have been obtained in prison. The inquest, which is expected to last several days, comes as NACRO report a massive increase in prison suicides. The 80s opened with 54 prison suicides between 1980 and 1982, but closed with 104 between 1987 and 1989. Brixton accounts for more than one in every 10 prison suicides. There were 8 suicides there last year, and this year so far there have already been 3 deaths.
The prison van was travelling on its way from the Old Bailey on the last leg of its journey to Brixton Prison Remand Wing. When it reached this bend, 3 of the prisoners on board made a break. One of them produced a knife and stabbed an escort officer in the stomach. He's now in the intensive care unit of St Thomas's Hospital.
The prison vehicle was similar to this, with 12 prisoners on board, handcuffed in pairs and guarded by 10 officers. One of the escort was held hostage by a prisoner with a flick knife, while his keys were used to unlock 2 pairs of handcuffs. The 3 prisoners then made their escape into Kennington Road. In nearby Radcot Street, one of the prisoners tried to hijack a car. The driver, an Italian aged 28, was stabbed in the stomach, but the prisoner was forced to flee on foot. The injured man was described as satisfactory in hospital. Because the 3 escapees were on trial, the police have said that they cannot as yet issue photographs of them. Indeed, they've been reluctant to say anything about the incident.
It obviously looks as though there's been some sort of organisation or planning into this escape, but the mere fact that a flick knife was smuggled on board the bus.
I think at this stage, to say that was organised in any great detail would be too early. I can't say at this stage.
Now, I know it's not the police's responsibility, but are you surprised that people standing trial on very serious charges, one of attempting to murder a policeman, should be taken on a bus, quite open bus like this?
I don't think that's for me to comment in relation to the investigation that's going on at present.
How would you describe these 3 prisoners?
I would say that any member of the public would have the knowledge or the whereabouts of these people was to telephone police, either here at Kennington or the local police station, and most definitely not make any approach to them. They could be very violent.
Last year, after the escape of IRA man Gerard Chewett from Brixton, security inside the prison was reappraised and eventually a new prison governor was appointed. Now it looks as though security outside the prison is going to have to be looked at, and in particular the authorities will want to know how men standing trial on serious criminal charges, including one of attempted murder, managed to smuggle on board a prison bus like this a flick knife.
Colin Baker for Thames News, Kennington.
Paul Worrell was a local boxing celebrity, a bantamweight champion and winner of countless trophies. He'd been arrested after a brawl in a pub, and the Crown Court decided that he should be sent to a mental hospital, as he was probably suffering from schizophrenia and had a history of suicide attempts. Although a bed was offered in Guy's Hospital, the authorities judged him too violent for an open ward, and he was returned to Brixton Prison, where he spent a total of 4 months, often in solitary confinement. On January the 12th, he was found dead in his cell. He had apparently hanged himself. Paul and his girlfriend had a six-month-old baby boy, and his family don't accept he could have killed himself.
The last time I took the baby to see Paul, and I was leaving, I told him I was going to have the baby for the week. And he said to me, that's good, mummy. Look after the baby for me. And as soon as I get well and get out here, I pay you back everything that you spend on that baby. And that's something was to live for. I don't think Paul would commit suicide. Not Paul at all.
The jury at the coroner's inquest did not return a verdict of suicide, but an open verdict. Local MP John Cartwright has called for a full inquiry.
Two things worry me. Firstly, that the medical authorities at Brixton Prison felt he was fit to plead against the charge, whereas two independent consultants both said that he was a schizophrenic who urgently needed medical treatment. I think the prison stopped him getting that medical treatment. Secondly, given that he had a record of mental illness, given that he had a record of attempted suicide, I am puzzled as to know how he could have succeeded in committing suicide in prison, where he should have been watched every minute of the day.
Friends and relatives of the dead man have set up a campaign and plan a protest march to Brixton Prison next month. This is Jane Corbin in Plumstead.
What would you like to see done now?
I think it's absolutely essential that we have a full public inquiry to establish, first of all, why he was in prison, and to establish, secondly, more importantly, how he came to commit suicide. Given that he was young and black, I think it's absolutely important that justice is seen to be done, and that's not the situation at the moment.
Friends and relatives of the dead man have set up a campaign and plan a protest march to Brixton Prison next month. This is Jane Corbin reporting.
When IRA suspects Piers McCauley and Nesson Quinlivan shot the man out of Brixton Prison on July the 7th this year with the aid of a gun smuggled into the jail, the prison service and the governor were blamed for the escape. But many in the prison service are convinced the findings of the inquiry which followed were used as a smokescreen. Its purpose to conceal a bungled special branch operation which had been running in Brixton. An operation kept secret from the prison governor and even the Metropolitan Police. It's alleged Staffordshire Special Branch planted a prison officer acting as an agent and informer in Brixton. He was encouraged to offer McCauley and Quinlivan an escape plan, a plan that would lure other terrorist suspects into a trap. The operation was aborted in January when the Special Branch agent was threatened. It was only then the prison governor was informed about the undercover plot. A bitter dispute has developed about what happened next. The police claim they gave very real warnings of a possible breakout. The governor, Reg Withers, who officially retired in October, maintains the police merely apologised for Staffordshire's secret operation. Gagged by the Official Secrets Act, he's unable to comment publicly, but a close friend and fellow governor has spoken on his behalf.
As the officer had been removed, and bearing in mind the assurance from the police was that with the removal of the officer, that should, in fact, remove the risk of escape. And given the maximum security prisoners' movement is a matter of headquarters, he made the assumption that all must be well.
5 months later, McCauley and Quinlivan were on the run, following an escape which mirrored the bungled special branch plan. Labour are demanding a statement from the Home Secretary and a public inquiry.
For Staffordshire Special Branch to be organising a breakout of suspected terrorists from Brixton Jail without the Metropolitan Police knowing, without the governor of Brixton Jail knowing, is something that is beyond belief.
And if a special branch officer was assisting in an escape, let alone promoting one, it's the Home Secretary's duty to ensure that he's prosecuted.
Labour today tabled a series of Commons questions about the breakout. The Home Secretary has so far refused to comment. On Friday, a disciplinary investigation cleared four prison officers at Brixton of any blame in the escape. No one has been disciplined at Staffordshire Special Branch, even though it's alleged the covert operation broke the law.